The Library Black History Month Committee and the Department of Language, and the Department of Mass Communication, Creative and Performing Arts, and Speech. We have a part of our lecture series that is to accompany our art exhibit on the American Music Memorial to Jazz Artists. The exhibit is in our library. We'll be there through December 16th. Tonight, we have Ahnee Sharon Freeman, noted African-American horn player and a member of the staff of the Jazz Mobile here in New York City. Ms. Freeman has played, or performed, I should say, throughout Europe and the United States. She tonight will do a presentation on the history of jazz, emphasis on the African culture that has survived through this phenomenal classical form of music. Ms. Freeman.
Thank you and good evening. I'd like to apologize for being late. I did not anticipate the amount of traffic coming down the West Side Highway. One of the things that's occurred to me over the years, I've been playing jazz professionally for about 25 years, and I've been playing music since I was 6 years old, and I'm 44, so you can do the math on that one. Can you do the math? One of the things that I've noticed over the years, particularly about jazz, is that everyone wants to take credit for the music. Everyone wants to say that we started it. And I've noticed in reading a lot of the history books, and this is the subject that I teach. I'm currently a faculty member at Bronx Community College, and I run the Jazz Mobile Workshop Program. And I've been doing that for 3 years. I've been teaching for Jazz Mobile for 17 years. But one of the things that I've noticed when I read the history is that nowhere in any of the history books I've ever read is there a mention of the fact that white people or non-Africans created this music. So it always astounds me, for example, when I read articles, when I talk to people, and they're saying, well, what did we contribute to the music? As far as I'm concerned, jazz was something that was created by African Americans. So therefore, I can talk with you about not so much what we contributed, but what we gave to the music, how we created the music. So that will be the focus of a lot of what I have to say to you, in addition to what Dr. Bennett has said. One of the reasons that we are not given credit for the creation of jazz is very simple. As we know, this is a particular type of society, primarily racist, and we have been traditionally separated from that which we have accomplished by not being given the credit. We were wiped out as a people in terms of when you read history books on any subject, there is no mention of the African American in the history of the country. And it wasn't until very recently when you read history books or discussed history with people that there was ever any acknowledgement that we had a history before we came to this country. I know when I was a little kid watching television, I sort of thought that all Africans ran around in the particular state of undress, that they had culture, that they had no language, that they had no music, that they had no tradition, that they had no history. Well, that misconception was relieved. I was relieved of that misconception by my grandmother and by my great-grandmothers and by my parents. And they began making sure that I understood the people who I had come from, the fact that, yes, we were brought to this country in chains and we were brought here as slaves, but we had a whole history, and in many instances, that history predates what goes on in Europe, the things that you read about in the history books about Christopher Columbus, about Alexander the Great. Again, if you peruse history books, you'll notice that many of the European explorers did manage to find their way down into Africa and brought back many of the things that they saw and many of the things that they learned to Europe. You will also notice that there is a record of Africans who did go into Europe and who did from time to time teach in the universities in Europe. And I say that to say that somehow all of that got lost when we got here. Everything was just wiped out. And an interesting sideline, there's an interesting sideline to that, how we were wiped out historically in this country. For example, in the culture that we come from, you have a mother, you have a father, and you have grandparents, and you are considered to be descendants of those people who are ancestors. In this country, we had a situation where one of our founding fathers, who later became one of the presidents of this particular country, had a situation where he was widowed. I think he was in his late 30s. He then began to have six or seven children with a woman, and that woman happened to have been the half-sister of his deceased wife. I'm talking about Thomas Jefferson. You see, so when you can have six or seven children by one woman who was considered legally a slave, and you do not acknowledge that on any level, you do not acknowledge those children, you do not marry that woman, you do not acknowledge the existence of the relationship, it becomes very easy to understand how we have been moved from the position of being the creators of jazz to the position of the contributors. That is about all that the society can handle. Now, when you think about when we were brought to the country, and you think about the music that eventually became jazz, what you realize is that you had three main races here. The first race, the first people here were actually the Native Americans. We know that the Native Americans did not create the music that we now know as jazz. They had their own music, been documented in the way our music has, such as it is. You had the Europeans who came over, and again, if you read the history books that they themselves have written, there is no reference anywhere in those books to the fact that they created jazz. So that, again, leaves us with the only people who were here who happened to have been Africans. And those were the people who created jazz. Now, as you probably know, the music that we call jazz is based on, a lot of it comes from the West African vocal traditions, because most of us were brought here from the coast of Western Africa. And as I said earlier, we did have our own musical traditions. We had drumming, we had polyrhythmic music, music that had many different rhythms happening at the same time. It was a highly sophisticated rhythmic sense that we had. We had call and response. A lot of our music used call and response. Does anyone know what that is? Right. And one of the first places that I saw call and response was when I went to church as a kid. The minister would say something and the congregation would respond, so that is carried over in our tradition. So there are a number of musical elements that came from Africa that were brought to this country that managed to survive. One of the interesting things for me is that many people claim that jazz developed in New Orleans, and there's no definitive proof. You had a lot of people who were known as jazz musicians, but that happened spaces. One of the reasons that people have referred to New Orleans as the birthplace of jazz is that the Africans who brought there were allowed to retain much more of their culture and their practices. You will find that those of us who were brought to the North were not encouraged to bring any of our culture with us. It was stamped out in many instances under pain of death. When you were dealing with the French, when you were dealing with the Spanish as opposed to the English, they were not so adverse to our maintaining the culture that we as long as we didn't get carried away with it. So therefore, this is why people say that jazz probably began in that particular area of the world. The other thing that's important when we talk about our creation of jazz is to realize that a lot of what we do is not valued. I'm thinking of the situations that I find myself in today. For example, I'm working with Bursa Ellington, and we're putting on his father's opera, Queenie Pie. We're doing that at Brooklyn Academy of Music on did it earlier in the year, and each time that we performed this particular piece of music, we were not funded in the way we should have been funded. The organizations just really didn't want to give up the money. And it's a sad commentary that we have someone of the stature of Duke Ellington, and that when you go to perform his work, you're still scrounging around for money. But again, that shows the lack of regard for the music and the lack of regard for what it is we have brought to the music. One of the points that I would like to touch on, for a minute, is that when I think of the music that I know as jazz, the people that I know of as the creators of the music, the innovators, the composers, the conductors, the performers, the improvisers, are always African American. And you can go back to the beginnings of example, if you think of Buddy Bolden, if you think of Louis Armstrong, if you think of Scott Joplin, if you think of Bessie Smith, if you think of Ma Rainey, and all of the names, you don't find one person who is a non-African American. And I think that that is very significant. It's a very significant point. When I say, for example, to my students at Jasmine Bell, well, what do you think of Max? Everyone automatically knows that I'm talking about Max Roach. If I say, what do you think of Louis? They know that I'm talking about Louis Armstrong. If I say Sarah Ella, they understand exactly who I am speaking about. And again, that is another way that I am made perfectly aware that we have been the creators of the music. In all of the years that I've studied the music and in all of the years that I've played the music, I cannot think of one non-African American performer, conductor, composer, or arranger that I have been influenced by. Or music I found it necessary to study on any great level. When I think about the study of jazz, I'm primarily thinking about some of the people I've mentioned and the more contemporary people. Those are the people that I admire. Those are the people whose music that I have studied. One of the other important things to notice is that jazz didn't just spring up full blown. It came from a situation of the West African vocal and musical traditions, but it was also preceded by spirituals, it was preceded by blues, it was preceded even before that with field hollers. So what we did, we were masters of acculturation on a certain level, where we took what it was that we remembered of our own heritage, and we slowly began to marry that with what we were hearing around us. For example, if you had been living 200 or 300 years ago and you were a white person, the music that you would have dealt with for the most part would have been the music of Europe. You would have been talking about Bach, Beethoven, Brahms, Haydn, or whoever. Or if you were not attuned to classical music, you'd be talking about folk music. And again, that music was not necessarily created here. It was created in Europe. You can link the music of Appalachia to the old folk songs of England or Scotland or Ireland. So again, that lets you know that even though there was music here, it took the mixture of the European and the African traditions to come up with jazz. The other thing that I would like to say is that we were forced into not using our language. We were forced into not being able to use our culture. So we had the double whammy of in addition, trying to learn another language, which is a monster. For those of you who study French, Italian, or Spanish, unless you hear the language and you are familiar with the language and have taught it, it becomes very difficult. We were not taught in that way. We just had to pick up on whatever. So when I think about that, I find it very incredible that there is any music created at all, considering the situations that we found ourselves in. One of the other important things to always remember was that the music, once we got here, was always here. There were always people who were doing the music. The concept that we came from was that we did not go to concert halls. For example, now if you want to hear music, you go to the concert hall. If you want to hear jazz, you go to the concert hall. If you want to hear classical music, you go to the concert hall. Our music was always very democratic on a certain level in that it was the music of the people. Therefore, anybody could make a song, whether it was a spiritual, whether it was the blues, anybody could sing a song. Anyone could perform a song, which is a little bit different from the European tradition, because when you deal with that tradition, you find that originally the people who developed the music were mainly people affiliated with the church, mainly the Catholic Church. Now, once we got to this country, our music filtered in through the church, but it filtered in quite a different way, and that if you were in that church, then you could sing, or you could play, or you could perform. When jazz was created, and again, we're talking about a time period in the late 1800s, because again, nobody can pinpoint the precise date, because no one actually got up and said, aha, this morning I am going to create this new art form. It is called jazz. When jazz was created, again, it seemed to spread under a power of its own. So you have people talking about, well, jazz started in Chicago, it started in New Orleans. The thing that you have to remember was that you had the Mississippi River. The music traveled up and down the river. You had a situation where, particularly after the Civil War, the freed Africans were able to travel a little bit. So therefore, I could go from this part of Georgia precedent in this, because in Africa, we spread the music pretty much the same way. We had people whose job it was to maintain the tradition and the heritage, and it came out through the music. In the early days of jazz, particularly in New Orleans, you had a situation where you had a lot of people, a lot of free Africans who could not read the music. The way that we finally got into reading the music was that we had a class of people called the Creoles. Those people were a lot of times sent to France, or they were sent to Europe, and then when they came back, they taught people how to read music. It was sort of an early each one, teach one that we hear so much about. And out of that beginning, we began to develop people. We began to develop very fine jazz musicians. How many people know of Scott Joplin? How many people have heard any of the music of Scott Joplin? Okay. How many people have heard of Buddy Bolden? Okay, he was a trumpet player or a cornet player before the time of Louis Armstrong. I'm sure everyone is here who's heard of Louis Armstrong. Is anyone here who has not heard of Louis Armstrong or Pops or Satchmo? He was born in New Orleans, and he played with bands down there, came up on the riverboats, and began to take the trumpet in another direction. One of the things about our early jazz players was that they created a music that set the standard. So you did have a big Spiderbeck, or you might have a Jack Teeterd, but they were basically beholden to the Louis Armstrongs, to the Buddy Boldens, to the Scott Joplins, to the Jelly Roll Wardens, to the Bessie Smiths. Okay, and that's an important thing, I think, too, that you want to remember about it. What has happened in this country traditionally is that you have a lot of people, for example, do what I call caboose. And if you know anything about a train, a caboose is the last car. So as things began to develop in jazz, you had the imitators. You had the people who came along and imitated. For example, this was why Benny reality, we know that that's really sort of a ridiculous statement, because if Benny Goodman were going to be the king of swing, then why did he have to wait for Louis Armstrong or any number of other people? Why didn't Benny Goodman spring full blown? You see, he had to wait. He had to do what I call caboose. You had Paul Whiteman, who was called the father of jazz. That's a little bit further along. But again, you could not have had a Paul Whiteman, you could not have had a Benny Goodman, if you did not have the earlier musicians who were forging ahead with the music and developing the music. Before I came this evening, I was doing something around the kitchen, and an advertisement caught my eye. I heard the voice of Duke Ellington, and I was wondering what it was about. First, I thought it was about the Queenie Pie thing, and it was Tony Randall, who most of you probably know from The Odd Couple. He now has a National Actors Theater, and there was a play by Shakespeare, the name of the play I did not catch, and the Duke had written the music for the play. So when you hear Duke Ellington speaking, and you hear the music in the background, and this is one of the ways in which we have traditionally been used. We have been used in terms of our performers to sell jazz, but we did not get the profit. So we set the tradition, we set the standard, and you turn on the radio and you hear Duke Ellington hawking a Shakespearean play, you see, which is a very interesting development. A lot of the music that we hear today, whether you're hearing Muzak in an elevator, whether you're listening to hip-hop, whether you're listening to rock and roll, owes a lot to the early jazz performers and to those who came after. So it's almost impossible at this stage of the game to turn on your television without hearing something of the West African musical tradition, without hearing something of jazz. A number of years ago, I believe in the 60s, you had a group called the Swingin' Singers, whose main purpose was to take the music of Bach and then do what you call jazz it up, or to take the music of, thinking about Dave Brubeck did the same thing. So there was a period where you had a lot of imitators who would take the music and they would do certain things with it and make the money. We, unfortunately, as the creators of the music, have not been financially compensated in the way that we should have, particularly in this country and in other places around the world. When I was younger, I used to wonder why people had to travel to Europe to carry on the jazz tradition. Why was it that they seemed to be much more supportive of the music and understood the importance of the music more so than we in this country did? Well, What I found out was that there was a respect that they had for the music. They knew who the innovators were. They knew who the creators were. That we in this country, because of the racial situation, found it impossible to do. We would find it impossible to say that Carmen McRae sings better than Anita O'Day, or that Ella Fitzgerald is a better singer than almost any other singer that you can think about, or that Errol Garner played better jazz piano than Andre Previn. So therefore, the only opportunity for us to keep the music alive, in a sense, was to go to other places. I've been all over the world playing the music. I've traveled to Europe on any number of occasions. I've traveled to the Far East. I traveled to South America. I traveled to Central America. There is a level of respect that was always accorded to music in other places that we have not had in this country. And I don't really ever know if that's going to ever get better. One of the other things that I found fascinating in thinking when I think about jazz is that in addition to the music and in addition to the creators and the improvisers and the arrangers and conductors, because of the strength of the West African musical tradition, we have been able to do a lot with it. For example, our culture, the African-American culture, at this point in time permeates a lot of what you hear. When you turn on television, you watch MTV, you see a lot of folks trying to dance like black folks. You hear a lot of, you have, what is his name, Marky Mark? You have disco people who are dealing with what we brought them, which is mainly the rhythm. You go to theaters to hear music. You go to theaters to see Broadway shows. You find the jazz element in the Broadway theater. You go to the supermarket. You hear the jazz element in the supermarket. Even in the way that people dress. When jazz musicians began playing and becoming recognized as jazz musicians, one of the things that I found fascinating was that they were always dressed. All you have to do is look at a picture of Lester Young, or if you look at a picture of Billie Holiday, or if you look at a picture of Sarah Vaughan. And that's one of the traditions that we have managed to maintain. If you go back to the West African tradition, you will find that looks are of great importance. The way you carried yourself, the way you dealt with yourself spiritually, which comes across in African music, and it also comes across in what we know as jazz. There's a moral component to the music that we still manage to maintain. There's still the improvisational aspect of the music that we manage to maintain. So there are a number of qualities that we do maintain and are very important. The difference for me in a lot of the classical music that I have played, as opposed to the jazz that I have played, is that there's not a sense of community. There's not a sense of family. And in Africa, there is a very distinct sense of family. That got to become part of the music that we now know as jazz, where you relate to the people that you're playing with on a certain level. There's an emotional bond. I can sit up and play Beethoven's Fifth Symphony 100 times in a row, and I don't feel any emotional bonding. And by looking at the other instrumentalists around me, whether they're white or black, I don't sense that they're doing any great emotional bonding with the music. As a matter of fact, one of the reasons I stopped playing classical music was I looked up one year, and I realized that I had played the G minor symphony by Mozart around 20 times with 20 different orchestras, but maybe 15 orchestras, and I hadn't gotten anything out of the music. The music did not speak to me in the way that other musics did. One of the things that I enjoy about being a jazz performer, and I know I speak for many performers, is that I can put some of myself in the music. And this goes directly back to the West African musical traditions. For example, if you've ever seen scenes of African musicians performing, you notice that many times there is a circle. That is a spiritual entity, the sense of the circle. You will see the drummers, you will see the dancers. The drummers support one another, the dancers support one another, the drummers, the dancers, and the singers support one another. That element of support was brought into the music, into the concept of improvisation. So while I take my solo on French horn, then I have a rhythm section behind me, and that rhythm section is not doing whatever it wants to do, but what it is doing is not predetermined. It's highly improvisational, but there is a sense that there are people with me, and this goes back directly to West African musical traditions. When I play in an orchestra, long as I play the note exactly where it is, and as long as I play it in tune, and as long as I play it loud or soft according to which some, to what someone has written on a piece of paper 200 or 300 years ago, then I'm fine. I can't bring that into a jazz setting because then it's going to be said that I don't swing. So there's a whole lifestyle, there's a whole aesthetic that goes into the making of jazz that you don't find in a lot of other musics. Last night at Bronx Community, we did a salsa concert. I didn't play. We're starting a new thing with the music department, collected funds from the student fees, and so we had Monday night was jazz night. I played that. Then Tuesday night, we had to do classical music so that everybody would be happy. And Wednesday night, which was last night, we did the salsa. Also in the salsa, because a lot of that music and the traditions also come from Africa, you had that same sense of heart. You had that same sense of feeling. As a matter of fact, all of a sudden I looked up and one of my students had snatched me up and we were dancing. I haven't danced anywhere in maybe 15 years, you see. But the music did that. And on Monday night, one of the interesting commentaries was when I went into the class directly after playing, one of the students said, you know, I really wanted to get up and dance. So I said, well, why didn't you? One of the things that we miss now with concert halls and that kind of thing is that jazz was originally a dance music. When I listened to my father speak, and my dad is, he'll be 69 in January, one of the things that he always impressed upon me was he got sharp, as he called it, and he went up to the Audubon, he went up to the Savoy, or he went here, or he went there, and he always talked about the pleasure of the dance. And when I was very young, my father and my uncle showed me how to dance. So it was not a big deal for you to come into my grandmother's living room or our living room, and you would listen to Duke Ellington, you would listen to Count Basie, and people would be dancing to the music and having a good time. You know, it wasn't a party or anything. It was just that someone had put this music on, and we just were responding to the music. And that, again, ties back with the West African tradition in that when you had drummers, you always had dancers. So the music was linked to the dance. You had singers. There was a connection. And many of the things that we do now, that connection musically has been lost. In Western music, if you want to have that type of connection, then you've got to have an opera. Because if you have an opera, then you have people singing at you in a language you don't understand. And then they may have a ballet, a bunch of ballet dancers, like the Met has a group of ballet dancers. So this is the only time when you listen to classical music, Western music, that you get all three of those elements combined at the same time. And it was very, very planned. Whereas in our music, it's not planned. This is just the way it is. This is how the music happens for us. So again, we still, even though many of us have not been to Africa, have never lived in Africa, almost unconsciously, we still retain a lot of the characteristics and the traditions that are used in the music. What I would also like to say, because I see that there are a lot of women here, jazz also provided an outlet for not many, but for a good number of musicians. You had Mary Lou Williams, you had Hazel Scott, you had Bessie Smith, you had Sarah Vaughan, you had Ella Fitzgerald. And again, this goes back to West African tradition where the mother is a special person. And when you have the European culture, the mother is not a special person in that way. If you are of Native American extraction, the same thing. You have tribes, you have clans where the woman is in charge. You see, this stuff of the woman not being able to do anything is a recent development in my mind. And in the music, for example, with Mary Lou, she helped Dizzy Gillespie. He would come by her house and he would listen to what Mary Lou had to say. She was an important figure. She also did the same thing for Bud Powell. I don't know how many of you know of Bud Powell. He was a piano player, a very fine piano player, who had the great misfortune to get himself beaten up by policemen, and after that, he was beaten very badly about the head. He had mental problems, you know, after that. So you have in the area of jazz, you have the tradition of women also playing a part. For example, with Louis Armstrong, a lot of the songs I discovered in doing research that you give credit for to Louis Armstrong were actually written by his wife, who was a woman called Lil Arden Armstrong. So she helped him a lot with the formation of his early bands. Lil had been to Paris, which Creole, but somehow she managed to get to Paris, and she came back and she began spreading the information that she had, which was basically how to read music and how to write music. So there is that component of the music that you do not again see in Western music. You had many situations in Western music, for example, with Handel and other people, where they had sisters who wrote, but the sisters wrote under the name of their more famous brother. See, and so that's an important distinction. One of the other things that also fascinates me about the music that we're talking about, the music of jazz, is that you had many people who came along and took from that music without giving credit to the music. I found it highly intriguing to find out that George Gershwin had been seen scurrying around Harlem at one point in his career, trying to soak up the music that he found in Harlem, and then he, you know, went and wrote piano concerti, and he wrote various pieces that were jazz pieces, that were considered jazz pieces, and I played some of them, and for my money, they don't swing. The music has reached out and influenced people in Europe. For example, Debussy, who was a French composer, came to this country. You had Dvorak, who came and wrote the New World Symphony, which was based on the Negro spirituals. You had Stravinsky, who was a contemporary composer. And you had a number of people who were influenced by the music and then went back and tried to work with the music. Our counterpart to that here would be Leonard Bernstein and Andre Previn, which I find fascinating on a lot of different levels. You also had, with the advent of the Beatles and a lot of the British groups, you had them taking from our musical tradition, but the difference between them and a lot of the folks on this side of the water was that they did give credit. You know, you read things where you see the Rolling Stones say, we were influenced by Muddy Waters, we were influenced by Ray Charles, or the Beatles will make the same claim. So there is some sense of giving respect where respect is due that we don't necessarily have, you know, over here at this point in time. The music, as I said, led to a particular way of dressing, and you can look at, for example, I love to look at old photos of Bessie Smith, who walked around like a true diva. What also happened is a lot of the terms that the jazz musicians have developed over the years have found their way into the language. So in addition to a musical thing, you now are talking about the direct influence of the jazz musician on language. You hear a lot of times people are saying things and you wonder, well, where did they get that from? It goes directly to the music. Some of it is related to the actual playing, you know, of the music, and other things that you hear people say just come from being around jazz, you know, musicians. For example, on one of James Brown's things, I forget what song it is, he's yelling about, take it to the bridge, take it to the bridge. And when I first heard that, I kind of cracked up. The bridge is a musical, formal term. He was not talking about let's go to the Brooklyn Bridge or let's go to the Manhattan Bridge. He was making a particular distinction. And you find this a lot. You find the youngsters now saying things that jazz musicians would say. For example, if I want to, it's funny, I'm a jazz musician, I can't really think of anything offhand. But there's just a whole language. I could, you know, say something might not understand at all what it was I was saying, or you might get bits and pieces of it. The other thing where the language of the jazz musician or the African-American is used, and when you have signifying, does anyone know what signifying is, or playing the doubles? It comes from the West African tradition, where the double entendre, you get all of that happening. But for example, when you have somebody talking about your mama, or you have somebody talking about your grandmama, or you have people saying things, but you know that they're really saying something different and not necessarily something you'd like to have said about you. This again comes from the West African tradition, and it was handed down through the jazz musicians. You also hear it a lot in calypso lyrics, the same tradition. So you see that wherever the Africans were brought, you have a lot of the West African tradition brought to Trinidad, to Jamaica, to Haiti, to Cuba, you have, in the music itself, you have scat singing, which is another use of language. Does anyone know what scat singing is? Mm-hmm. Can you do it?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. So that's scat singing. Excuse me.
There's another form of scat singing.
Uh-huh. master of that. You see, how many people know Moody's Mood for Love? Here I go, there I go, there I go, da 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 da. I can't remember the words. You see, that was actually a horn solo. So again, you have the use of language in another way, which is very prominent in the music that we call jazz. You have a very interesting thing happening with that, because now when you listen to the radio, when you watch television, you hear people say, for example, Scooby-Doo. There was a show called Scooby-Doo. And the first time I saw that show, I said, well, where'd they get that from? Or there was a character, if you're old enough to remember Dobie Gillis, there was a guy called Maynard G. Krebs, okay? And most of the time, Maynard G. Krebs was talking about, yeah, man, I'm on the inside and the outside and the outside and the inside. And that's a typical jazz musician thing. It has a double meaning. I could be on the inside and the outside, meaning that I'm on the inside of the piece of music that I'm playing, or I could mean, to show you what I can get up here.
Yeah.
Okay. I can just take a standard piece of music and would listen to jazz. They were 14 years younger, 12 years younger than my dad, and 6 or 7, so they were kind of into Miles Davis and Charlie Parker, and my dad was known for Jimmy Lunsford and Duke Ellington and Count Basie. For them to appreciate the music, they would go into my grandmother's living room, pull down all of the shades. It could be high noon. They would close all of the doors. They would turn off all of the lights, and they would put on those tams or those berets like Bud Powell or Monk Ward. You look at the pictures, and then they would begin to listen to the music. So they had adapted the jazz musician stance. Now, when we do that, we're in a club. But it was interesting to me as an adult when I reflected back to that time period that they would feel that this was how you had to listen to the music. And if you go into clubs, if you've been to jazz clubs, you see those types of people in jazz clubs, just as you see that blues singer everywhere. In little clubs in Brooklyn, for example, when I first started playing, I used to play in a lot of clubs in Brooklyn that don't exist anymore. And we would make a deal with the club owner, you know, you come and let us play. And we'll take $20 and divide it up among 15 people, you see. And working in those clubs when I was 17 or 18 years old, I saw all of the quote-unquote stereotypes, and I saw how they played out in the society, and I saw that for us, they were very, very real. Now, the thing that I've always liked about blues, and again, it connects to the West African musical tradition, is that you talk about what is real to you. You see, I can make up a blues about the fact that I came down the West Side Highway and ran into tons of traffic and got hung up on the bridge and couldn't get across and almost got out of my Jeep and got ready to kick somebody's butt because they cut me off, and that would be my reality. You know, you could make up a blues about whatever you want. Sometimes when I work with youngsters in school, the blues that they always want to make up is what I call the I hate school blues, you know. But that's their reality, you know. Or their reality is that they had to get up out of bed, or that they had a fight with their sister, or that the dog ran away, or whatever. So our music encompasses all of that. If you look at the titles of a lot of the songs, you had Filthy McNasty, which was a Horace Silver tune. Nobody has to sing you the lyrics to that tune in order for you to figure out what Filthy McNasty is about. Or you had a Cannonball, I think either Cannonball or Nat Adderley wrote a song called the Jive Samba. So again, jive is a word that comes out of our music, and it has any number of meanings and connotations. So again, you can write about whatever it is you want to write about. If you go back to other traditions, the West African tradition, you could see, or even if you go into the Calypso tradition, for example, if you did something that I didn't like, I was not really capable of writing a song to honor you, quote unquote, I could get someone to do that for me. I could get someone to write a very negative song about you and stand in front of your house or wherever it was you were situated and do that and sing. So that would be my particular reality. Now, the European musicians didn't really get hip to what I call the reality thing until the 1800s, and they called it programmatic music. And so you have things like the Moonlight Sonata by Beethoven, or you have the 1812 Overture by Tchaikovsky. You see, we've been doing that all along. One of the things that we've also retained, which is sort of in keeping with language and then you heard Billy Preston do Blackbird. It sounds like two different songs. Or if you take a song that Aretha has done, and then you listen to a white artist do it, it sounds like a totally different song. Because what Aretha is doing when she's singing, even though she is not a jazz musician, she is still coping with the West African musical traditions of embellishment vocally and the scales that came out of that type of music. Now, these scales cannot be, many of them, written down. We have approximations of the scales. And that's why a lot of the European musicians got bent out of shape. Well, how can you sing this if you can't write the scale? Because we're singing quarter tones, we're singing half tones. Now, you will find this in Oriental music. You will find this in music of many of the islands in the Pacific. So it seems like for some reason in Europe they got stuck with what we call the temperate scale. And they had nothing in between. Whereas our stuff is totally different where you can sing in and out of the cracks of the music. How many of you have gone to church, even if you don't now, when you were younger? This is always an interesting question. And when you listen to the music there, the hymns, let's see, actually, maybe this should have been up here. You'll notice that many of the hymns that you sing, I was brought up AWME, African Wesleyan Methodist Episcopal. Mm-hmm. And so when I looked at the hymnal when I started playing, and sometimes I'd play in the church, I would see something that looked like this. I was six, and so I became aware that I had this, there was this very square thing on the page. But when I heard the people around me singing, it became totally different. Church into the other music. When I was young, well, I was fortunate. I had two great-grandmothers and two grandmothers and two grandfathers and one great-grandfather who died when I was young. But one great-grandmother's thing was that you didn't play rock and roll, you didn't play jazz because it was the devil's music. Now, my other great-grandmother didn't really care. She just liked music. This was also the other thing that happened in our West African tradition, where because of the religious beliefs of some of us, that we took the music, we had to take the music out of the church. Like Ray Charles went that way, Mahalia Jackson went this way. So if you listen to Ray Charles, if you listen to Mahalia Jackson, you realize a lot of times they're singing the same music. Ray Charles had a big hit with I Got a Woman Way Across Town. That came out of This Little Light of Mine, I'm Gonna Let It Shine, which came straight out of the church. Sam Cooke was another one. Sam Cooke made a decision. He wanted to make some money. So again, he came out of the church, you know, with all of his vocal traditions intact, and he moved it into another area. Aretha Franklin was another one. Dinah Washington. So when you begin to look at our rock singers, our pop singers, when you look at our jazz singers, you will realize that they came out of the church, and so this was how those African musical traditions were preserved. And my church, which was Bridge Street, they had a lot of fun with music. You had a gospel choir, you had a chancel choir, you had the women's choir, you had the men's choir, you had the kids' choir, and then you had just the large choir. So you got to hear a lot of different kinds of music. But I always knew that there was a line beyond which we would never go, even though we were fairly free with it. So like I said, the music started out one way, blues, field hollers into the church, then you had a separation. We now have, for example, places where you can do jazz masses, so there is a jazz vespers, let's say. So there are now situations where they are bringing the music back into the church. And I think that's all for the best. But originally, for example, if you go back to the New Orleans time period, if you went to a funeral, on the way to the funeral, you would play a hymn, you know, whatever, and it would be very, very sad. On the way back from that funeral, you would take that hymn and you would jazz it up. And this was the beginning, or the beginnings of our jazz band. You had trombones, you had cornets, you had saxophones, and you had clarinets. This is where we get the Dixieland players from. This is where we get our ragtime players from. So there's been an uneasy alliance between the music of the church and the music that we call jazz. But at the bottom, it's all coming from the same source. One of the other things that I think that is important for us to remember is that we have to, at this point in time, I think, assume responsibility for what happens with the music. One of the things that Bronx Community, I teach a music, I think a music 11 course, so the students have to go to classical concerts, which they balk at, so I play Let's Make a Deal. You can go to one salsa or one jazz or one rock or one pop, but you gotta give me two classical concerts. And so people go for that. Now, when I was teaching a jazz course up there, several jazz courses, one of the things that I found very disturbing was that we did not appreciate our own music. And that is disturbing to me as a performer. So it means that when I go to play in clubs, for the most part, I'm looking at a white audience. Or at these days, I'm looking at a Japanese audience. You see, because the Japanese are everywhere. And we don't place any priority on our music. We don't place any priority on the struggles that we have had as Africans and African Americans in developing the music. We don't do anything about the music. If you study the history, for example, you know that you have the Chitlin Circuit, you have the circuit that was in the South and also in the North, where if you were a black performer, no matter how well you played or sang or danced, you were only able to go on this particular circuit. You could only travel and play in these particular clubs. Your travel accommodations were difficult because you were dealing with segregation, you see. And now that we have more of an opportunity, for example, I might play at the Village Vanguard, which I've done on any number of occasions, but I don't like to play because they're cheap, you know. Or you play, if I play at Sweet Basil with my band or another band, or if I play at the Blue Note, I find that we don't support our own music. I recently became acquainted with a woman, a Jewish woman, in a school in East Harlem who is working very hard on her second grade is with this music we call jazz and with the West African musical traditions. They managed to get a street named after Mary McLeod Bethune, I think it's 134th Street. These are second graders. And I'm glad to see that the work is being done, but it hurts me to see that out of that whole school of primarily black instructors, that no one takes that type of initiative with the children. And I was having a conversation with her, and she was saying, Oh, yes, well, today I played Ornette Coleman for my second graders. And I don't know if you've ever heard Ornette Coleman, but that's some difficult music. Or she told me one day that she had played Well, You Need It, which is a monk tune, Thelonious Monk, and monk can be difficult music to listen to. My students at Bronx Community a lot of times will tell me, oh, we spent $40 or $50 to go hear Madonna, but if I say I'm playing at the Village Gate, they won't come and spend $20 to get in. Or it doesn't have to be me, it can be any artist, you see. And that's a very frightening thing. We complain a lot about the fact that when the history books are written, we are not mentioned in the history books, you see. We do not write the history books for the most part, and we do not push for our own music when we have the opportunity. One of the things that I think is very important is that knowing that the music programs in most of the schools have been cut, that you as a parent or a brother or a sister take an interest in that and go into the school and find out about ways of bringing music into the school, specifically jazz. Because I found in traveling all over the world, I can work with very young kids. I remember being in Taiwan to do a concert, and we got there, the band got there early, so we were backstage eating, and all of a sudden, I just heard this huge sound, and I could not even begin to describe to you what that sound was like. I thought for a minute an airplane was crashing, because I just heard air. And so when I asked someone about it, they told me that there were 10,000 people who had, no, I'm sorry, 7,000 people who had come to hear this concert. You see, and these were very young kids who had, many of them were young kids who had dragged their parents because this was the big thing. They didn't really get jazz there a lot. So they made this effort to come to the concert. They had traveled, many of them, very hard and long distances to hear the concert. And we stayed backstage for several hours to answer questions through an interpreter or through a translator and to sign autographs and to take pictures. While I was in Taiwan, I also did a number of workshops with youngsters, 5, 6, 7 years old. One of the things that always gets thrown up in our face here when we talk about preserving our musical tradition is that the music is too much for the children, that the children are too young, that they don't understand. And my experience with that is totally the opposite. I can teach you anything if your mind is open. You see, I bet you if I were running the country, I could get jazz funded. You see, in a culture where we can promote a Madonna who can't sing, or any one of a number of other artists, what we're talking about is media, and what we're talking about is hype. For example, I don't know how many of you remember a singer, quote unquote, named Peter Lemangello. Peter Lemangello. Okay, Peter Lemangello was a very wealthy businessman who decided he wanted to sing. So he got, he paid publicists and press people, and they really pushed Peter Lemangello. I think he played at some big venues, and he made a couple of records, but the bottom line was Peter had no talent. And I guess Peter got tired of putting out the money. But even something like that shows you that if something is properly promoted and produced and developed, that there is a market for it. So getting back to the educational thing, one of the things that you should be trying to do is to bring more music into the schools, whether you have elementary school age children, whether they're junior high school, because that is not there. Now, if we were able to get on an airplane and get funding or get a benefactor, I could take you over to Germany to the Hochschule, and my German is not really wonderful. This is a school that they have, one of the schools they have in Germany, where they are teaching jazz. So many of my musician friends go over there to teach, and one of my friends has been offered a full-time position. So he's teaching in Germany, learning German, but he doesn't have to because they speak English. Another friend of mine goes to Austria in Graz every summer because, again, they're hungry for the music and they are willing to pay her to go and work for 6 weeks and to do the music and to teach the jazz and to teach the West African traditions. In this country, we don't do that. And it is going to be our loss because what is happening now is our music is playing everywhere in the world. For example, last year, I think it was, I was flown to Japan as part of a band to play one concert. Now, if you've ever been to Japan, it's a tedious, tedious flight. I think you're on a plane 13 or 14 hours, and it's a 12-hour time difference. So by the time you get there, go to the hotel, go to the venue, warm up, play the concert. You're back on the plane all the way back home, you see. And but in this country, we won't do this. the amount of money that I got paid for that concert, and I also got more because I was doing the business for this particular band. So for a day's work, I walked away with about $4,000. You see, now in this country, to try to make a living off jazz or to make that kind of money, unless you reach a certain point, that becomes an impossibility. I have people who want me to come back to Fiji. I was there a number of years ago simply to set up a school and run a series of workshops. Because I've taught for Jazzmobile for 20 years, and I'm now the musical director, so I create curriculum and that kind of thing. So, you know, we're talking, I can't turn down the money because I want to buy a house. So this year I'm doing anything I can possibly do to get this house. And if that includes going back to Fiji or wherever, I will, you know, do that because I think this country doesn't provide me with the opportunities that I would necessarily need. In closing, I would like to say to you, really, to support the music, whether that means that you go to the concerts, that you buy the albums, that you buy the CDs, become more aware of what is going on in this community. When I grew up in Bed-Stuy, there were a lot of little clubs that my mother was having heart attacks about because I was going to these dives and I was playing. You might want to check out what your local club scene is. And remember also that you have many fine practitioners of the jazz art who were born right here in Brooklyn. I grew up in a neighborhood where Randy Weston lived. UB Blake lived down the block, but I wasn't aware of UB Blake at that time because no one had told me. You know, you want to find out who's in your neighborhood. You want to read the papers. You want to read the reviews. Because the bottom line is this is your music. And if you let this be taken away from you, then you literally have nothing. Because you want to remember that the music itself comes from a very, very rich and ancient tradition, and that it is very important. Thank you. Thank you.
Comes on and off campus quite a bit with us, and I hope that she will be able to do some other performing for us as she has done in the past. We can't pay you $4,000. Why not? Okay.
I'll take care of it.
You take care of it.
Get her phone number.
Get that lady
again.
Phone
thank
number.
You. That's Tori.
Oh.
December 3rd concert.